Hello friends, today we are going to have a small discussion on a very interesting inherent conflict within the Constitution of India. This Constitution of India, which provides you fundamental rights under Part 3 of the Constitution, also provides another right, this time the power of the Parliament to amend the Constitution of India under Article 368. What is this inherent conflict and why was this inherent conflict so crucial that it made the background of one of the biggest battles being fought in the Supreme Court regarding of who is the superior article or which is the superior article? Is it Article 13 of the Constitution, which is written in Part 3 of the Constitution, or is it Article 368, which is given in Part 20? But before this, if you read the Part 3 of the Constitution of India, which deals with fundamental rights, it starts from Article 12 of the Constitution, goes all the way till Article 35. For the sake of our discussion today, I am more interested in Article 13. The long and short story of Article 13 is that there should be no law. There should be no law which is violative, which is abridging, which is contravening anything given in Part 3 of the Constitution. Give it a layman language. What is it saying? That there should be no law which should be violative in any form possible, anything written in Part 3 of the Constitution. Let's go to Part 20 of the Constitution and read Article 368. Article 368 provides the Parliament of India the power to amend the Constitution of India. If you read Article 368 even more carefully, you will see no exceptions are provided in that. So, on the one hand, you have Article 13, which is saying, in layman language, don't touch Part 3. If you read Article 368, it says the Parliament can amend anything. So, within the same book called the Constitution of India, you have an inherent conflict. Who will win? Now, the first time this happened, the first time this conflict came into limelight, was when Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, our first Prime Minister, and his government, way back in 1951, made the first Constitutional Amendment Act 1951. When they made the first Constitutional Amendment Act, they provided Article 31A, 31B, and added a new schedule to the Constitution called as the 9th Schedule. So what is 31A, 31B, and 9th Schedule? Actually, at that time, most of the land in India was under the Zamindari system. So, land acquisition for the government was becoming very, very difficult, or in fact impossible, constitutionally impossible, because Article 31, which, if you understand, was a part of Part 3 of the Constitution, was a part of fundamental rights. So, the government could not do what is called as land acquisition, which is a very popular word today. And therefore, Article 31 would not allow the government to acquire the land. So, to bypass this fundamental right, the Nehru government passed Article 31A, 31B, and the 9th Schedule as the first constitutional amendment. This was challenged in the very famous case of Shankari Prasad Deo versus Union of India, in which the Honorable Supreme Court found that there's nothing inherently violative of Part 3, and hence first constitutional amendment is or was taken to be constitutionally valid. The same thing was repeated in Sajjan Singh case, which was in 1964, when the 17th Constitutional Amendment was again challenged on the same grounds, that it is violative of Part 3 of the Constitution. So what are we actually having a war between? We are having a war between Article 13 on the one side, which is saying don't touch Part 3, and Article 368, which says Parliament can amend the Constitution of India and no exception is provided. This war was hotting up, and then suddenly came the Goloknath judgment. In Goloknath judgment, 1967, a huge overruling happened. For the first time, the Honorable Supreme Court said that Article 368 can amend every part of the Constitution, but not the fundamental rights. And a word was used that the fundamental rights, as provided in Part 3 of the Constitution, forms what is called as the basic part of the basic structure of the Constitution. The then Indira Gandhi government passed, in retaliation to Goloknath judgment, the 24th Constitutional Amendment Act 1971. Now, what is it saying? In very short, long and short of it, it said nothing that is written in Article 13 can amend or can alter or affect the amending power of Article 368. What is it actually trying to say is that the Parliament is the supreme power, regardless of Goloknath judgment, regardless of whatever has been provided in the Constitution. Now the 24th Constitutional Amendment Act 1971 of Indira Gandhi government, the previously overturning judgment of Goloknath judgment, as well as the old pertinent question, is Article 13 the exception to Article 368, or is Article 368 unlimited, was challenged in the greatest case or the largest case India has seen. A 13-judge Supreme Court bench was formed under the leadership of then Chief Justice Sikri, and it was H.H. Kesavananda Bharati was the State of Kerala 1973. His Holiness Kesavananda Bharati was the State of Kerala 1973 after months and months of deliberations and arguments, both pro and against, of various facets of the Constitution, finally settled down on one principle. That said, number one, Goloknath judgment is hereby overruled. What does it mean? Fundamental rights can be amended by Article 368, number one. Number two, Article 368 can amend every part of the Constitution, but it cannot destroy, it cannot tear away the very fabric of the vision of the Founding Fathers of the Constitution. And this very fabric of the vision of the Founding Fathers of the Constitution was called as a name, was called was Basic Structure Doctrine. Basic Structure Doctrine, as the name suggests, was in the Kesavananda Bharati judgment gave us in the form of several examples. Examples were democracy, republic, secularism, Article 50, free and fair election, and so on and so forth. When I say so on and so forth, it is not a way with words, it is an actual word. What does it mean? It is an evolving doctrine. Evolving doctrine means as and when a case comes to the cognizance of the judges in the Supreme Court and the High Courts and so on and so forth, exercising their powers of judicial review as provided under Article 13, it is open for the judiciary to deliberate upon the case to, on case-to-case basis, whether or not a particular amendment, a particular law, a particular action, a particular order of the state is tearing away or violating the basic structure doctrine. If it does, it shall be held as ultra vires and struck down from the Constitution of India. So, from the Shankari Prasad Deo case in 1951, all the way till Kesavananda Bharati case of evolution of basic structure doctrine, we have come a long way, all in all, for one particular aim. This is a democratic country. Not one power should have all powers. Not one power should have been unlimited. There should be no one who is not answerable to the Constitution of India. This, my friends, is the evolution of basic structure doctrine. I hope you like this video. If you like this, please share, please like my video, and wait for my next video. We'll share another judgment of the Supreme Court.